That's good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, that's a question I don't hear for the first time, and also a couple of times asked. It's the Euregio joke. Euregio stands for the whole region of Germany, Netherlands, and Belgium here in my place in Aachen in Germany. So probably Eureg joke.
Okay.
So I just can continue while Tom fixes his setup. Thanks for the kind introduction, Tom. Yeah, my name is Michael. One other confusion often related to me is
Okay, another try. So all settings tell me that it should work. Can somebody hear me? That's awesome. I didn't change anything. I just restarted OBS. Okay.
Fantastic. So great. Where were we? I think we've been starting to speak about working from home in COVID-19 times, and I was just telling that I started to work for Neo4j 2 years ago by the end of the month, and I've started as a remote employee 2 years ago, and yeah, I always enjoyed working from home. I tend to overdo things when I'm really in the mood or in the flow of working. And I had this a couple of times, even in my old job when I was not working from home and commuting like everyone else. I had a blog post out for a conference by Venkat Submarai. Okay, that's bad. I had a conference talk proposed for Venkat's conference Dev.next about that topic, how to avoid burning out doing what you like. And my approach has always been a lot of sports, a lot of exercise that helps me clear my mind to get away, actually physically away from the desk. I rather don't play computer games these days, but go for a run, go cycling or swimming, or play with the kids. What changed in COVID-19? Our whole company is now remote, and that's about it for me work-wise in our team. At home, there are now 3 more people in the house doing my workday, my wife and 2 kids, so that changed a bit. Yeah, and we already spoke about that, that the whole homeschooling situation in Germany is at least challenging for everyone, I guess. But that's basically it.
So my experience is for me pretty similar. And at some point, I also decided, okay, keeping the same lifestyle as I used to have in my early 20s just doesn't work out in my late 30s. So I actually had to start sports and stuff, and that's something that definitely changed with the whole COVID-19 situation, with sports clubs closed, gyms closed, and everything. But yeah, I think it's an important thing to learn to balance between work, especially if you love to do your work, and other activities that maybe are not that stressful, even if for me software development and all these kinds of things normally don't feel too stressful, but at least if audio and everything works. Yeah, I think sooner or later, most people get to the point where they need to recognize, okay, there has to be some kind of a balance. I think it was great that you published that as a blog post and then shared your experience with that. And I was surprised that this was never really a topic on conferences before. At least I didn't saw that. And there are always discussions on doing speaker dinners and stuff and similar events, but
I had several discussions on various speakers dinner regarding that special topic. And my experience, what I had several times, it's a two-edged sword. If you really like what you're doing, then it's good fun, it's interesting, and it keeps you occupied. And at the same time, you are in a big danger to becoming a single point of failure in your company or in your family setup even so, because you only focus on one thing. And you accumulate all the knowledge if there's not a good team around you that prevents or that helps you not becoming a single point of failure. For a brief period of moment, being maybe that 10 times developer feels good, but it's not good on the long term. It's not good for yourself, and it's also not good for a team or the whole company in the end. And that's something I try to propagate. That is definitely not the ultimate goal, to be that person. Yeah. Quite the contrary, and that reduces stress.
Yeah. By so extent. To everyone who's interested in this, I recommend to visit Michael's blog at michael-simons.eu. So basically the name that you can see here on the screen, and I think Michael now, I hope he posts his URL to the chat.
Yeah.
There you can find a multi-part blog post, three or four posts. Yeah. It's definitely a good read and something that from my point of view, everyone should start thinking about. But maybe let's get to a bit more work related. I'm not so sure if everyone is interested here about that. Let's talk a little bit more about the work that you said that you're doing from home and that you like doing, which is working for Neo4j. So what is Neo4j? What are you doing there?
Neo4j is the name of a company who creates a database with the same name. Neo4j is a graph database, a so-called native graph database. We store data with a focus on relation between things, and we store them in a way that makes it very fast to traverse relationships, and it makes it rather simple to query those relationships by a declarative query language, which is called Cypher, which is our pointer to SQL. And I work in the drivers team at Neo4j, and the small sub-team we call the Neo4j OGM plus SDN team, where OGM stands for Object Graph Mapping, and SDN stands for Spring Data Neo4j. I do this together with a colleague from Germany, Brett Meyer. He does not live near my place, so we have been remote from the start. Yeah, that's what I'm doing at Neo4j, maintaining the Object Graph Mapper and our integration with Spring Data Neo4j. That's the main point.
So for everyone who doesn't know Neo4j or hasn't used a graph database so far, when should you use a graph database? What do you think are the main benefits compared to a typical relational database?
I see the main benefits in each scenario where the relationship or the clusters created by relationships between different things are the the main point of interest. If, for example, in fraud detections or recommendation, which are very similar from the implementation point of view, in every scenario where it's interesting to find clusters of papers, for example, we have a nice open database called the COVID-19 graph. It's a nice project for related to papers and research regarding COVID-19. That's the area where I see value of a graph database if it's focused on relations and their traversal. There's a plugin for Neo4j that implements all kinds of graph data science, finding, for example, a page rank algorithm is in there, many, many more graph algorithms to traverse nodes and their relationships to, basically to traverse the graph. If it's more about analytic queries, I would still focus on a relational database. That's what I've been doing basically all my career before that. And I still see a lot of value in there. Having said all that, it makes my work really interesting because when I work with an object mapper, regardless if it's object relational mapping, I mean, that's where Torben's work stands out or where he's really knowledgeable in the sense of Hibernate ORM and JPR ORM, then you model relationships as object relationships. And it may seem trivial to just take the object relationships and put them in the graph and vice versa. It's rather not if you're trying to create a general purpose object mapping framework.
Yeah, especially if you consider that a graph database is really good at working with huge graphs. I mean, connecting one or two objects in a relational database and with Hibernate or most other ORM frameworks is simple and easy and totally fine with an SQL database. But working with huge graphs, that I think is something where graph databases just where they use a different approach, and for these use cases, it's probably the better approach because they are working with very deep graphs with lots of nodes. It's way simpler and way faster than other things. So that probably makes the mapping different, right?
Difficult. People take the assumption that they can have really huge, gigantic graphs stored and query it rather fast and just take that and put it on the application side of things. I mean, I keep telling, if you remodel your graph in a one-to-one way from the database to the object mapping, then you're rather recreating your own graph database on the application level side of things. And OGM or other object graph mapping frameworks have the same difficulties than Hibernate would have with relational databases in creating bidirectional relationships, circular relationships, and whatnot, what the graph database itself can store very easily. But that's get out of hand very quickly when you put it in an object mapping framework, which is suited for all kinds of problems.
Yeah, okay.
And my personal answer to that, and which we created a new approach for, is the same answer I'd given several times in talks about SQL and relational databases. Use the object mapping frameworks for sensible subgraphs modeled after a specific use case in your application, modeled after a domain entity or an aggregate of your application. Don't try to look at your database scheme and take it like it is to the application world, but rather find your aggregate use routes, find your use cases and model them. The object mapping frameworks, all of them, really helps you greatly to have all that kind of CRUD operations and even some complex query operations. to model it and to create an application for it. If you want to go deeper down and you want to use analytical queries in your relational database, or you want to apply graph algorithms to your graph and you want to find new connections to it, then I would always go for the native way of doing things, either a SQL way or a Cypher. And there's no shame in that. Those tools are meant to be used together. I want to have an easy life while creating a bunch of data. And as long as I can model my use case without jumping through loops, I mean, we, at least Torben and I think we have both seen our fair share of Hibernate code, which was far from optimal. And that's not Hibernate's fault. People trying to make their way around in Hibernate or in OGM without going down the Cypher or a SQL route and building huge amounts of codes that make only their life and our lives harder in the end. So I would always go for a native way of doing things.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And what I see or hear in a lot of discussions that always is, yeah, but there has to be that one standard way that apply to all of my problems, which in my experience just doesn't work. And that's probably the same with OGM. I mean, on one hand, that's one of the great things that makes our job interesting. We have always new problems. We need to find a way to solve them. I see us as software developers mostly as problem solvers. So our main activities, at least from my point of view, should be solving problems and communicating to understand what are the problems and then what is our approach to solve them. And then just taking one way to solve an issue and apply that to each and every problem that comes our way just is problematic. And in my experience, most of it doesn't really work. And seems like that's also the thing that you just said with mix the mapping with the native query approach and then basically do what fits the use case, right?
I would not try to it's seldomly that one problem or one set of problems is solvable with the dogmatic approach. If there's a dogmatic approach in a project, we must only use JPQL, or we must only use entities, and we must never use the query language, then you will find yourself in a scenario sooner or later where people work around that issue in interesting ways. And those interesting ways are usually the one parts of the code that are going to hurt you sooner or later.
So yeah, you can follow these constraints and implement your application in summary, but you shouldn't expect that the code will be maintainable, that anyone will understand it, or that it performs well in production. All of these things will most likely fail. But it's most database frameworks are powerful and complex enough to put a lot of constraints on the way you implement something and then still be able to implement your use case. It just doesn't mean that it's a good way to implement it. Quite often it's not. So you already mentioned it, and I saw quite a few articles about that recently. You released a new framework. No, it's not really a new framework. It's a replacement of the old Neo4j SDN OGM, right? The RX.
So at the moment we have a nice framework which is very closely modeled after JPA and Hibernate plus Spring Data approach. There's one library that does all the heavy lifting of object mapping, and one integration with Spring, which is Spring Data Neo4j, which is very similar like Hibernate and Spring Data JPR A works. And when I speak at the moment about object mapping, I mean Neo4j object graph mapping. That thing has a couple of ways it can work in. It works with an embedded Neo4j database, it can work with our HTTP endpoint, and it can work natively with our Bolt driver. Bolt driver is the thing that is most closely related to JDBC. So there are a couple of horizontal options there. And to that complexity comes the vertical approach. You stack Spring Data Neo4j on top of it. That works fine as it is, but in the last 3 to 4 years, there was a new topic on the blog, which is called reactive programming. It's all about making better usage of available resources, especially threads, and being non-blocking overall. We tried several approaches to lift OGM in a way that it can work, it can create object graphs on the client side, non-blocking, but we didn't really find a way around it. It's not solved by slapping reactive types on a thing and do blocking in the backend behind the scene where nobody sees it. And OGM is especially made in a way that it tries to get everything from database it needs to for creating a subgraph on an application level, and that's kind of contradictory to what I want in a reactive programming paradigm. I want to have chunks of data. If you like, I want to have rows or record sets and process them as they come by. So we needed to re-implement, to rethink that. And we started something which we've been calling SDN RX, short for Spring Data Neo4j Reactive or whatever you want to call it. And we noticed shortly after we started that approach that we can do a couple of things better in here. First of all is usage of Spring Data Commons. Spring Data Commons is usually something that is behind the scene, but does a lot of great stuff in regard of object mapping. I get a mapping context for free. The mapping context can give me all kinds of information about class structure, about classes I found on a class path, which made up my domain model. It gives me all the information about which attributes of an object have been annotated with arbitrary annotations, which annotations are on a class. It also has facilities to create instances of those objects, and it does so by creating bytecodes for classes that can only be created via constructor calls. So there's a lot of benefit in it. I get immutable data classes for free just by using the Spring Data Commons API. I have ways to create new instances for Kotlin data classes, for Lombok data classes, or even for Java 15 record classes. So that's kind of cool. And that was our first approach, to set purely on that and don't run our own thing. Second approach was the extensibility of things. We wanted to get away from both horizontal and vertical stacking of things together. We wanted to have a simple approach, like a kid would work with Lego, starting at the first, put another stone on it, and next, and so on. And we started with a very simple client that just integrates with Spring transactions, with both reactive and imperative transactions. Then we added on top of it template mechanism like you used to from Spring Data Mongo and even from Spring Data JDBC. Those templates, they can be asked for domain model so that you get a fully hydrated subgraph back, but you don't have to go all the way through creating repositories for each thing that is annotated with entity. And last step is adding the repositories itself. And having that composability makes it, at least in our opinion, very easy to get started with the whole thing on the in Springland.
Okay.
And there was a wall of text. I'm sorry, just interrupt me if you have questions in between.
It was really interesting to get some insight on what was the whole idea behind the new approach you built with it. But maybe to sum it up, what would you say? What are the main important differences for a developer who's using it compared to the existing solution? What would be the main reasons to switch to the new approach, besides that the new one is reactive and the old one isn't?
And the new one is also imperative, so you can use both programming paradigms with it. Actively migrating a project from the current thing to the new thing without having a need. I'm going to answer the question later. If you have a working project and you don't plan on going reactive, then there is no need to migrate it. I mean, that's usually the case. One argument of migrating things is if you have modeled a lot of entities and you all want to create these entities, but you don't want to have a repository for each and you want a simple templating mechanism, then you can migrate. If you're running a lot of custom queries, you make it much easier to run those custom queries, plug in your own mapping mechanism. For example, you can even use MapStruct or something else if you want to. That would be a good reason to migrate.
Okay. Yeah.
That would, and if you want to go full reactive, then going that road would be your only option. And one more thing in the pack is that we have created a DSL, a domain-specific language for creating Cypher from Java. And I mean, that can maybe answer Martin's question in the chat. So we at Neo4j actually think that Cypher is a rather simple query language, at least if you think about it, like expressing things you would do on a whiteboard. But I agree, it has some kind of edge cases at some point.
Yeah, so I can totally understand, Martin, and I agree with you as well. So, but I would say Cypher, similar as SQL, is complex in itself because it's solving a complex problem. But if you have used Cypher for a bit and spent some time on it, it's not as complex as it might seem in the beginning. It's a lot, well, I almost said it's a lot easier. But I would say it's just a solution to a really complex problem. And if you're used to it, and if you got used to thinking in a graph-based way and really get used to the concepts, it has a manageable complexity, it's a language similar to Java or SQL. You need to learn it and you need to use it. If you just write a query every 2 or 3 months, then it's tough.
And it is as complex as you need it to be. I've just posted in the Slack. Select stuff from FUBAR versus match FUBAR return something. It's rather not complex, and that's also the level. I'm really happy if an object mapper does that for me. There's no need for me to write a query of that kind, not at all. That's generatable. On every language behind that level, there is naturally more complexity involved. That's just the way things are.
Yeah, I think one challenge here is that if working with a graph database is just a little bit different from based on graph theory and all the concepts that are part of a graph database, and by that also of Cypher as a query language for a graph database. But that's the whole thing. I mean, you choose a graph database because you have a use case that's a good fit for it. That's a good fit for the way of thinking that's required when working with a graph database. And yeah, it's different, and you need to get used to. But yeah, if you have a use case that fits to the technology, it's definitely worth it to put some time into it.
I hope I don't tell something super stupid and I get beaten up by my colleagues later on. But I think that a graph, once created, is more often queried in various ways than it's rewritten. I want to have help by creating the graph with all the quad objects or my domain objects, and then I often have the use case of running very different queries on top of it to explore it. And maybe that's part of the complexity.
Yeah, probably.
It's one thing to create an application to just store data, and if I want to just retrieve those objects again, I mean, that's kind of boring. I want to explore new relationships. I want to form, maybe I want to do some new modeling on it. I want to derive new nodes and new relationships from it. That's probably something you do much more often in a graph than with a fixed schema in a relational database.
Yeah.
That could be one main difference.
Yeah.
And regards of Cypher, what I was saying before, we created a Java API to create Cypher from Java. We are using this internally in SDNRX so that we don't do any string concatenations at all. And we have a syntax tree at hand to generate the queries we issue in the end. And originally, we wanted to use this only internally. But for some reasons, users found the API, found it interesting, and are actually using it at the moment. And I'm quite happy about that. And that's the Cypher DSL has also some history, I'd say. I've been using Juke for SQL for quite some time. That was, of course, an inspiration. I've seen what the colleagues at VMware have done for Spring Data JDBC. They're doing something very similar internally, which I liked very much, and I think it's a great approach to have a real syntax tree at hand in an object mapping framework. I mean, it's already helpful to do for having parameter placeholders that change. Maybe want to handle different construct differently. So, and that makes it's really easy with a syntax tree at hand. And we're quite happy. We have done this, and we're also quite happy to have extracted this as an external module. Maybe it makes writing Cypher for folks easier, for folks coming from the Java world.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. But at least for relational databases, there's always been a huge interest in a good Java DSL to write SQL queries, and Lucas Eder solved that with Juke pretty nicely, I would say. I would expect it. Well, already is, or quite soon will be the same for Cypher as well. It's just a pretty natural thing, I think, that we would like to create dynamic queries at runtime using DSL with Java.
So one other thing we always noticed, that probably you've seen this as well, Many projects that try to use an object mapper, doesn't matter if it's relational or graph, for doing batch loads. Have you seen
as well? Way too often,
How do you answer that if you find mappings, really complex domain mappings, and then you get a bunch of CVS files or whatever there is, and people complaining this is slow? What's your answer to that?
I try to kindly and politely tell them that the current approach that they are using is just not a great fit for the use case. Because the whole mapping is is focused on a record-centric approach, like I would have for all the use case implementations that I have behind a graphical user interface, where someone is sitting, typing something, browsing through data and stuff like that. And for that, all these mappings work perfectly fine. They also work fine if you have a few records that you want to write or update or something. Let's say you have 10, 20 records that you want to insert or update. That's still okay, but that's not no longer the case if you have a huge batch jobs. So I've worked with customers who do their who create monthly invoices for whatever kind of contracts. So they have thousands of customers, and for each of them, they need to calculate stuff and create an invoice, and they do that at the end of the month in a month nightly batch run. And yeah, quite often the first approach there is, yeah, let's use the existing stuff that we have there. And let's be honest, it's a horrible idea, because something that works great on a small scale doesn't work on a way bigger one. I always try to compare that to cars and trucks. It's totally fine to have a small car for two persons to go from your place to the office or shopping or something. It can be a small car, doesn't drive fast, doesn't have a lot of power, totally fine. But you would never have the idea to use that car and put a huge, a huge trailer behind it and expect that it works perfectly fine. With object mapping, we exactly do that. We build something that works for a small amount of data, and then we just say, yeah, put a loop around it. What should happen? We have everything in place. That doesn't really work.
I'm quite sure we find good images to create memes on that one.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure about that.
It's a small car. Yeah, but I totally agree. I mean, all kinds of interesting stuff happens. I mean, you build all the graph on the client side. We've seen our session context explode because many, many thousands of objects and having it all in one go. Then things explode on various level. I mean, can be the session context, can be the application transaction, all kinds of interesting out-of-memory errors. And that's also something we had in mind while creating a new thing, so that we can actually create batches from the client and go outside the whole mapping. Just integrate with Spring's application level transactions. So if you would do this in Spring Batch or whatever, that you have a transactional around it in some ways that makes sense, but you don't have all the mapping overhead, which is more or less useless, I'd say, in that scenario anyway.
Yeah, especially if you have use cases where you just try to store a lot of data in the database. So it's basically a write once operation, and if a few hours later somebody else might use that information. Well, then just performing the write operation without any additional mapping overhead and storing something in local context and everything is, of course, the best approach. But that doesn't fit well to an object relational mapping. Not because that approach is bad, it's just the wrong tool for that use case. In German we say, if you have a hammer, the all problems start to look like a nail. And it's the same approach here. If you just have object relational mapping framework in your toolbox as a software developer, then and you start trying to apply that to all of your problems. And I see that quite often in projects, unfortunately. And yeah, that just doesn't work well in the end.
What I find interesting, and I mean, that's a personal opinion on that. If you say, yeah, that I think it's a wrong tool, maybe use that solution and write a query yourself. There's always an argument, but then I have to replicate the column names and whatnot.
Yeah.
And running into danger of duplicating things. I mean, I think that's really not the best argument. It's only my impression that we are duplicating tons of things already in some application setups, but the things that would be worth duplicating when done with care, we don't do,
yep.
Which would have really benefit. So, well, if the only tool you have is a hammer, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And another thing that regarding writing your queries that I then often hear with Hibernate is, yeah, but then I need to support the different database, so the different DBMS myself. That's probably something that you don't hear that often with Cypher and Neo4j, but with relational database, that's something that then gets complained all the time. And yeah, well, then that's sure an issue that you need to solve. But
I have heard the question 2 times,
okay,
from in regards of competitors to be able to use our mapping frameworks with their buff databases.
And does it work?
I don't say anything. But some competitors support Cypher. Cypher yep. is a more or less open standard. There's also a thing called Open Cypher and then ongoing ISO standardization to create GQL graph query language, much like the SQL standard. So based on the Cypher level, it would actually work if it's fulfill the standard, but not on the protocol level at
yeah.
the moment, due to our board protocol. But yes,
that's what
regarding relational databases, you heard a question so many times. What if I want to do switch databases? Yeah, you don't.
Yeah,
most of the time.
Most
often,
yeah.
So I mean, if you have a product that you want to be able to sell to a customer, and the customer is free to choose the database, okay, then you need the flexibility of changing the database, but on the application you're running in-house as a company, not related to IT itself, not creating a product IT rate, but just running an application, I've seen it only once that the customer wanted to change the database.
Yeah.
Once in 20 years.
That almost never happens in my experience. And then you still have the option to support the different DBMS with different queries. So just writing multiple statements for the different DBMS, and at least with JP and Hibernate, you can easily externalize these query strings and put them into external mapping files. And yes, that's annoying, totally agree, but managing 2, 3, 4 versions of a query and do that for, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 queries is way easier than working around the limitations that you would have otherwise and trying to optimize that. So yeah, it's always
completely agree. And if you have the requirement that you want to be able to switch databases, it you don't get this for free, and that's just the wrong assumption. That it's just flipping a switch.
Yeah, well, you get it relatively cheap if you stick to the most basic set of mappings and database features.
SQL 92?
Something like that, yeah. If you want to be able to switch databases for cheap, you have to pay that price. So you're really limited with the features, and you need to live with the performance that you can achieve based on that feature set and based on the standard mapping capabilities. But one thing has to be clear. If a framework that supports multiple databases, is supposed to offer features that work on all of these databases, you can only have a feature set that's supported by all of these databases. So everything that's special, that makes one specific DBMS interesting and a good fit for your use case, is most likely not directly supported by that framework because it's not supported by other ones. There's a question from or comment from Jens. As soon as you have two transactions accessing the same data, JPA's database independence goes out of the window.
I'm unsure, actually.
Yeah. Not sure if I understand the comment. Why can't you use? That's right. So Jens' main argument is that transaction isolation levels and the defaults are different.
That's a very good point.
Yeah. But you would at least need to put quite some efforts into it and make sure that you find a configuration for all DBMS that is as similar as possible and hope that your application doesn't create any corner cases that.
So what Jens is saying in the chat is transactional isolation level implementations and their defaults are different between databases, and JPR does almost nothing to fix that or basically does no work on that area. And you're speaking probably about also about lock levels and whatnot. Yeah, and that's very deep down into the database to that depth where most developers never go, I would say, or many developers don't go in the standard, just create a REST API on a database level.
Well, at least not voluntarily, yeah?
good point, yeah.
But that causes issues, and that's quite often something that doesn't show up until you test your application in great detail. That's probably one of the points where your migration that looked easy and perfectly fine then fails horribly. And unfortunately, that's probably just a few days before you plan to go to production because it's something that's hidden rather deep inside.
And it's probably some error, especially when we're speaking about isolation levels, that will hit you only when the thing is under load. So not when you put it live.
Yeah.
But like half an hour later. Speaking of testing, what's your current approach to testing database interactions?
It's in general, it's a problematic topic because testing database interactions in theory is simple, right? You just need a database and you trigger a few queries and you see if it works. But as often, real projects are more complex and testing applications with databases. There the main issue is you need to have a data set that really fits to the test case. And that is something that is rather hard to create and maintain for a complex system. So a few basic recommendations there would be to not mock the database level. Fortunately, this doesn't seem to be the preferred approach anymore for a lot of teams. In the past, had a lot of discussions about that where architects told me, yeah, and then we mock everything and
on the repository level.
Yeah, exactly. So the repository level got mocked, and they told me that this is a good approach to test the database, and I strongly disagree with that. If you want to test your business logic without a database level, then make sure that your algorithms are can be tested by unit tests without a database. And if you interact with the repository, then make sure that you use a production-like database. So it should be the same DBMS, and it should be a set of data that's similar to the data that you would find in production. That would be my general recommendation. Then test container as a framework is quite a good thing there, because it makes it easier to spin up certain test databases. What's your take on that?
Thanks. I actually agree with you on all the level, especially not mocking the repository layer. I've been there myself a couple of years ago. It's snake oil. It just doesn't help in finding bugs with the database interactions. Also, experience firsthand the issue of a data set which either fits the test case not at all, or is way too small to find or spot performance issues. I mean, that's a classic issue. You model your thing, you think you're doing everything right, and your algorithm and your queries are also fine, but then you see the production database and it grinds your application to a halt because your queries are not good. That's quite a challenge to find a good data set. And I also agree with using test containers, and I made it my personal hill I'm battling on to get people away from using embedded Neo4j for testing. Mm-hmm. It's really easy to get a Neo4j up and running for testing, but that comes with a price, which is the Neo4j is written in Java, or not only written in Java, but runs on a JVM, so you get a bunch of Java dependencies, and we experience a lot of issues on the class path with that. If you test this in an application, there are good reasons to use an embedded Neo4j in tests, especially when you write plugins for Neo4j. Then I would, alone for the fastness of startup, always use an embedded version. That's superb. We have a test harness for that. But if I want to run tests for my application itself, I would go with test containers extension.
Yeah.
Simple as that. So that would be my preferred way of doing stuff. It reassembles the thing you are running in production the most in the end. You have not an embedded connection, you have something over a socket or a network connection. You maybe are able to shape that in a way that reassemble production for you as well. That's maybe also of interest, especially if you run Neo4j in a cluster. So Neo4j as a causal cluster deployment scenario in the enterprise version, that is, you need at least three instances as the leaders that replicates to himself, and you maybe want to find ways to test your application against that one so that you have same causal transactions. That's even more important, I'd say, to test that setup then. So agree with you all the way.
Yeah, regarding the you mentioned performance problems and that they don't show up in the test. My recommendation there is always to have one test instance in your pipeline that runs on one of the latest dumps from production.
If you can get
it. Yeah, exactly. Getting a dump from production that is several days or weeks old quite often is an option if you define a clear process for that and document that based on data privacy laws. You might need to jump through a few hoops to get it, like removing personal information and stuff. That's something that can be automated. It's something that is actually doable. And all the information, in almost all cases, all the information that we're removing there is nothing that we actually need. So we don't care what's the name of the customer, or what's the address or email address, or stuff like that. But what we would like to know is, okay, what is the general structure of an order or whatever data we are storing there, and what's the overall quantity? And then the important question, does our query work on a full data set? Something that works on 100 records quite often doesn't work that well on a few million records, which quite often gets ignored. So we have a question in chat from Ram Kumar. Spring Boot or Django on Node, what is future?
CGI is good. I don't know. It's hard to...
Same for me. So I've no experience with Django on Node, so I would say Spring Boot and hope for the best, but
I mean, these are different things, right?
Yeah.
Spring Boot is a framework running on the JVM. Node would be somewhere mostly to the JVM on that level. I think Django is a Python framework to do web applications.
I think so, yeah.
So different things that have been asked here. I've been working with the JVM now for 20 years. Java is now 25 years old, and I see good chance that it will last another 10, 20 years with all the stuff going on in regards of new language constructs in Java itself, with improvements in the JDK and on the JVM themselves. So I would bet on something on the JVM. Regarding Spring Boot, I mean, Torben was so kind and put my book behind or next to his own book in the background. I have written a book on Spring Boot, and I still very much like that framework and like the community behind it. It's a very general purpose ecosystem. It can get out of hand if you pull in tons of dependencies or tons of aspects altogether. Because it's just we had earlier with query languages. If it's only a very simple project with one aspect to it, like creating a REST application, that it's only one dependencies, but you can bring in database dependencies, security and whatnot, and then there's a lot of stuff to configure. And that's just the way it is. If I've added 5-6 ingredients to something, then stuff gets complex. And but it's still quite usable. There are a lot of other contenders on the JVM. A couple of those I contributed to myself. There are good other frameworks out there, like Quarkus, for example. And I personally like that, that those challenges, those new approaches. If you think about Spring, it's more than 15 years old. It supports programming models that are like 10 years old. You can still easily upgrade 10-year-old applications to the latest Spring framework versions. I'm not speaking about dependencies that get pulled in, like Hibernate or OGM. Those tend to be harder to upgrade, but the Spring framework itself supports all of this for like forever in an IT life. While new contenders don't have to do this and they can rethink stuff. I mean, we all love to start writing greenfield projects. It's the same with framework developers, I guess. At some point, people to start freshly and bring in good ideas, and that's happening on the JVM like a lot with Quarkus and Micronaut, and it's a good thing because the Spring team sees this and notices it and incorporates ideas which are possible to incorporate in the Spring framework. So
I think it's necessary. In the past, Java EE, which is now Jakarta EE, and Spring were the two main competitors, and for quite a while, it felt like it was a tough race on an equal level, more or less. And then in the last few years, it felt like Spring, well, it was just the more innovative framework, which probably was also caused by Don't want to get into all the dirty details, but all the issues and controversies around the specification process and who has which IP rights and everything with Java EE. So due to all of that, Spring, especially Spring Boot nowadays, seems to be the most dominant enterprise framework in the Java niche. And having then new competitors like Micronaut and Quarkus, and to some extent, maybe also the whole micro profile initiative, keeps the whole market, well, on one hand, interesting for us as a developer, but it also introduces lots of new ideas. And that's, I think, one of the main reasons why Java isn't dead. And it hasn't died over the last few years, I think. So I started professionally working with Java about 19, almost 20 years ago. And I think all the time I read articles and discussions about how dead Java is, and that is the end of the framework. And it's still at the top of the charts of if you look at open positions and which skill sets are requested. So, well, if that how a dying or dead language looks, then I like working with dead languages.
Yes, totally fine.
Yeah, and as long as we have always.
Torben, I like working with dead languages.
Oh, I should have said that. yeah, but as long as we have competing frameworks that adapt to new challenges and new trends like microprofiles, like React, like microservices and Reactive and all these kind of things. I think it's good for the whole ecosystem, and one of the reasons why the whole niche stays interesting and innovative.
And just before we answer that question by Bob Lopko, regarding the point you brought up regarding Jakarta EE, and I mean, that's a kind of unfair comparison, right? It's easier for a de facto standard like Spring Framework to evolve very fast. It's much easier than for a real standard or community and organizational driven standard like the Jakarta EE ecosystem. They're not to blame at any. It's just the fact that those standards evolve slower than a de facto standard. Maybe it's not always obvious, but all those frameworks usually use the Jakarta EE or Java EE standard to some extent. And there's a lot of good stuff into it as well.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And I think the standardization process that we have with Java EE or Jakarta EE is the better approach based on the idea that we have multiple teams working on competing frameworks that serve the same issue. And at some point, all the teams discuss which of the ideas they introduce should be part of the standard, so which problems were solved in the same way by multiple teams. I think that if you take that approach serious and if you give it enough time, that will produce the better solution, because it's based on swarm intelligence and based on having multiple prototypes and more ideas than can be provided by a relatively small team that's working on Spring. But on the other hand, a de facto standard, as you said, is way easier to adapt and change than having something based on multiple implementations and then needing to agree on something and so on. So yeah, it's probably an unfair comparison. Spring, in a lot of cases, integrates external libraries or implementations of the Java EE specifications, which is one of the reasons why Jakarta EE is so relevant on the market, and also one of the reasons why the team at Pivotal can provide such a complex and huge application stack with such a small team, because they pick good implementations and integrate them into the whole ecosystem, which in itself is valuable, definitely.
Apart from that, I usually work on a day-to-day basis with both of the Spring ecosystem and parts of the Jakarta EE system. I mean, what do you think how the REST endpoint in Neo4j is implemented with? It's with JAX-RS, and the dependency injection thereof is with HK2 and Glassfish implementations. So I've been working with this together on a daily basis.
Same for me. I mean, I specialized in JPA and Hibernate, and that basically means that already is probably more than 80% of what Spring Data JPA offers. Having both is
interesting.
So there's a discussion going on in the chat. So
I think we need to kick Ben Jens. So Jens, that your kids didn't come with tutorials. Mine didn't either, actually.
So
we had a couple.
We had a couple of questions in there, right?
Yeah. So let's start with Torben. How would you explain isolation level to your kid? I mean, it's older. He's older than 5 years old, but
isolation level and explaining to a 5-year-old. Well, let's say you have a bag of sweets and two kids. So you and your friend, you share a bag of treats, and both of you want to take something from the bag. The isolation level then shows or defines if and when, you see if your friend takes something from the bag, or if your friend sees that you take something from the bag and attendance, what happens if both of you try to get the same sweet from that bag?
Beautiful.
Does it explain it?
Yeah, it would be a definitely good start.
Yeah.
So I would try to get on with the persistent context for a 5-year-old. The persistent context, at least in the sense of Spring Data, would be the box with the toys and the manuals of the toys the kid is keeping in his room. It contains the blueprints of how to create new constructs from parts that are thrown into the box, and it also contains some constructed versions of the parts, some updated versions of the parts, and maybe instructions on how to save them.
So now the chat has to decide if we actually did a good job.
Yeah. So what do we have here? I already posted some link to the Neo4j sandbox. There was a question, how can we start learning or working on Neo4j? If you go to neo4j.com/sandbox, you can bring up your very own Neo4j instance that comes with some tutorials, and those tutorials include data as well as instructions. So, for example, you can play around with your Twitter account. You see who follows who, and there are some example queries. You can always start with our movie graph. There are example data sets with Panama Papers. I think we have something on Trump as well, but I'm unsure on that one. There's a lot of things you can get started with.
Mm-hmm. And André asks, regarding integration testing of repository layers, what is the best approach to do it with Spring Boot? What's your favorite approach? We already touched briefly on that. And I think we both agreed that, at least for the database part, the test containers framework and spinning up useful test data sets in production-like databases is our preferred approach, right?
And there is both for Neo4j as well as for JPR, there are so-called test slices in Spring Boot. you have the option to bring up your whole Spring Boot application if you annotate the test with as at Spring Boot test. That brings up controllers, services, repositories, and whatnot. And if you don't want it because it's maybe a bit of slow starter, then you can decide to fire up only at data Neo4j test or at data JPA test. That brings up only the JPA entity manager or the Neo4j OGM, the persistent context, transaction layer, and the repositories. And there is a way to integrate the test containers project with it, which is through a new annotation, namely dynamic property sources, that makes it really easy to modify the context so that your connection doesn't use an embedded database but goes to something in the test containers. Those test slices start up faster, and also the tests roll back automatically after they are done.
That's good. And then there's a question from Abakar. Is Neo4j 100% open source?
Yes, the open source edition is 100% open source. We have, of course, the Enterprise edition as well. The Enterprise edition is not open source. It comes with a bunch of more features, which is multi-database support, which is the cluster support, and a couple of other things. This thing is not open source. That discussion would be good enough for at least another hour or two to discuss about. Neo4j is doing tons of stuff in the open source, but in the end, folks need to be paid as well, so we don't give away everything. That's just it.
Yeah, I mean, that's a reasonable approach also used for a lot of other by a lot of other companies. And in the end, if we as developers or the companies we are working for want to use a complex tool like a database for a commercial project, then we should also be able to make enough money from that commercial project to actually pay for the tools that we are using.
Exactly.
Okay, and then we have a question from Framot. How to remove left outer join while associating one-to-many relation using parent class key as join column?
You take this voluntarily.
Do I?
Isn't that something you just get out of this?
The first question there would be, did you add the left outer join to the query yourself? Did you write the query? When does the left outer join show up, and why? What exactly are you doing there? Answering that question without seeing the mapping or the query isn't easy. I'm currently wondering if there's a default case that adds a left outer join when you're using a one-to-many relationship. So first of all, you shouldn't map a unidirectional one-to-many association with Hibernate. That's handled very inefficiently. But that's another topic. And if you do a quick Google search on that, then you will find an article in which I show what the issue is and how to solve it. The short answer there would be make it bidirectional. To have a mapping that's similar to the table structure. But regarding the left outer join, if you can provide a little bit more input on that, then I'm happy to take a look at it. Or if you need some more time to prepare that, then maybe you can post it on Stack Overflow and send me a link to it. I will look into it.
Cool.
Or maybe we make that one of the questions that I answer on the next stream, which will most likely be Wednesday in 2 weeks. Next week I'm teaching a customer workshop, and I will do that on site, so I'm not sure if hotel Wi-Fi will be good enough to do a live stream. Most of them aren't, but I will give it a try, and you will see on next Wednesday if the hotel Wi-Fi is great or not. I'll post it on the blog. That's also great. Post it there. I will take a look at it, and then we'll see what's actually going on there. Okay. Well, we talked about a lot of things today. Are there any more questions, especially about Neo4j or Spring topics that you guys want to ask Michael?
Maybe just see if I find my slides about SDNRX, which we talked about earlier.
Yeah.
I hope my oh, that's your window. That's the wrong window. So the link I posted. Yeah, thanks, Tom. That's awesome. The slides and the short talk explains our train of thought behind what we're doing with SDNRX. I think it's helpful to understand the framework, because usually the experience and the history of people's projects go into frameworks, and it helps to use it.
Yeah.
Let's have a look. Hope you like it.
Yeah, and then you can find Michael at michael.eu. I post that to the chat and to the video description as well.
Yeah, perfect.
And then we have another question by Vishal. Can we return DTO to UI? Yes, of course. So with Hibernate and JPA, that would be the recommended approach for basically all APIs. I think separating entities from your API is actually a good thing, because it keeps your database and API independent of each other and makes a lot of things way easier, especially evolving the software over time. How do you see that for Neo4j and
mixed feelings about that. I'm the type of lazy guy who often just returns the entities, but also burnt my fingers with that a couple of times already, because they, in the case of JPA, entities are still attached to the entity manager, can go wrong, especially if you automatically generate JSON from it. And the thing traverses all relationships, which may be not hydrated yet,
yeah.
And you get the infamous lazy initialization exception.
Or a horrible performance if you
fetch performance.
The associations.
We don't have that exception in Neo4j OGM, but we can run into the same horrible performance problems with huge subgraphs as well. I would do this with great care if I would just use the entities on the UI layer. So I basically would agree if you have a... Oh, stuff went blackout. If you have a huge domain, do yourself a favor and run DTO objects.
Yeah. Okay. Well, Michael, then I would say thanks a lot for your time and answering all these questions and giving us some insights into Neo4j, especially Neo4j SDNRX. Yeah.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, it was a pleasure. If you guys want to learn more about Michael or Neo4j SDNRX, you can find the links here in the chat, and I will add them to the video description. And if you understand German and use Spring Boot, then I highly recommend this book up there, Spring Boot 2. It's a great book for to learn about Spring Boot and understand the concepts that are applied by Spring Boot when you are building an application. So I think if you read that book and start building your Spring Boot application, you will not be confused about missing defaults or stuff that works in a tutorial but not in your application, because Mike does really a good job on explaining all these things so that you know what's going on internally.
Thank you. So, yeah, from my side, it was a pleasure talking with you, Tom. That was a great afternoon. I cannot highly recommend your Hibernate Tips book enough. I have my own copy just above me. Used it a couple of times when still working with relational databases. I think SQL is rather easy to handle, fighting the complexity of domain of configuration of an object mapper can be much more challenging, and your book helps a lot with it. And I really like the approach you have in your book, like the questions and solutions for stuff. That's really helpful to pick up your problem and find an answer. I like that approach. Regarding Neo4j, Garrett Meyer, who was so kind of answering all the questions in the Slack, and I am monitoring Stack Overflow. We have a community Slack and a community site. If you have any questions on Spring Boot and Neo4j in combination, just ping us there. Choose one of the channels we monitor, not all three of them. That helps a lot to coordinate answering on stuff. And we are there for you, and we really like having you out.
So again, thanks for taking the time to join us here, and thanks for all the kind words about that you just said. And to everyone who enjoyed this stream, I will definitely be back in 2 weeks, probably with a Q&A stream where I just answer questions from the blog of YouTube channel, probably Stack Overflow. I might be streaming next Wednesday as well, a little bit later. As I said, I'm teaching a customer workshop, and then to see if the hotel Wi-Fi is actually good enough for a live stream. Okay, take care, guys. Stay healthy, and see you soon. Bye.
Take care. Bye.